5 squat variations that can take you beyond what a back squat or front squat with a barbell can. They might just change your lives. I don't know. I hope so. I'm sorry you have to stare at me as a sweaty mess, but I did just work out in Louisiana in the middle of summer in a warehouse gym. That big fan, not helping a heck of a lot. Well, as we rage against the dying of the light right outside Atlas Strength Shop, which you've seen me in before, I figure it's a good time to talk about the first squat, the only squat that requires equipment, a barbell or just a stick. And a rack is really helpful. And a pair of these are my Serious Steel bands. Check out the website below if you want your own. They come in many flavors, from skinny little ones to thicker, tougher ones. And yes, I just happen to be carrying several pairs around with me. I do, they're in my car all the time because I use these for many, many things. Anyway, this one's called an overhead squat with dangly bits. I'm not gonna go into detail about how to do them, but they're an overhead squat with dangly bits. Let's talk about some details about squatting. It's pretty important to get into right now, because it pertains to all the squats in this video. I know when I say we're all different, we're all gonna squat different, you're gonna go, duh, but we need to get some stuff out of the way. For instance, an overhead squat is a great indicator of where you are on your squat journey. Not so much, holy shit, that was a big, giant bolt of lightning. Maybe I shouldn't be standing out here making a video. An overhead squat is a prime example of how we're all different squatters, how we're all built differently. We've got different things going on. I've got some friends that can put their feet together, put their hands together, hold the bar, and do a full ass to grass overhead squat where their butt hits the back of their calves. Here's what happens when I try that. Now you try it. Grab 3 people. And all of you try it, and you're gonna have 3 different results as to how far you'll go on that. The good news is, it doesn't mean anything. It is not an indicator of your skills in any other way. It's just sort of a fun little test. You know how much I love tests. It's a fun little assessment, just to see how all bodies are different. Now keep in mind, I compete in sports that require squatting, but I will never be able to do that. Does that mean that I'm gonna lack in performance somewhere else? No, it just means we're all built a little differently. Without going into huge detail, let me explain a few things just so you can get an idea of how different we really are. Our body consists of 3 sections that differ so much per person, it can affect your squat hugely. Upper torso, upper leg, and lower leg. Even with 2 people with the same height and weight, those levers might be so different that you have 2 entirely different looking squats. If your shin is a little longer and your upper leg's a little shorter and your torso's a little longer, you're probably gonna be more upright, as an example. Whereas I have to hinge forward quite a bit to get my squat successful. That's just one aspect. Now imagine all the mobility components at the joints around those levers. From the shoulders to the entire spine, to the hips, to the knees, to the ankles, we've got a lot of variables that can affect that even further. So just those 2 aspects, your levers and your mobility, create entirely different squats for every single body. Which means a lot of the dogma that's out there right now about squatting, how you're supposed to do it these ways, probably wrong, probably not gonna work for everybody. Let it go. A squat is 2 basic things. Hinging at the knees, hinging at the hips, which I am right now, and then extending those, straightening them out. So then you straighten them back out. Bend at the hips, bend at the knees, boom. And then you're able to straighten those back out. That's a squat. If you're loading the body, add 2 more things, keeping a good spine and sitting between the legs. So a loaded squat is 4 things, that's it. In fact, for our entire squatting life, we're just trying to get better at those 4 things. Anything else added to that should be simply to make those 4 things better. But oh my gosh, people have complicated the heck out of the squat with all these little details and bits of information we don't need right now. When we start arguing about what goes where and what does what, we're missing the point. So, with that in mind, let's talk about these squats. The overhead squat with dangly bits. Even for somebody that has that beautiful overhead squat where they can put their feet and hands narrow and still stay very upright, can be loaded in such a way that it's going to benefit everyone skill-wise. Now, it's not a leg exercise. This is a squat that's not necessarily for your legs. Sure, they'll feel it a little bit, but it's for everything above your legs. It can be a huge contributor to everything here what we call the steel V, all those important back muscles that actually increase your postural awareness and help you with so many other things. Lots of skill crossover from this little jam. So the purpose of this is not to grow heavy. It's, of course, the three Ps. Be precise, be present, be purposeful. And this mofo of an exercise is going to get you to do those three things. It is going to get you to be all that, well, you can be in that moment. The bands add something that my buddy Jason C. Brown calls a heckle. You're being heckled by the dangly bits. There's a lot of cool ways to heckle things when you're moving, but this is just a fun one to do with an overhead squat. An overhead squat is a great movement on its own. Turning it into an exercise that's being heckled crosses over to a lot of things. It's a huge skill builder. And because you're not super loading it, because you're not going really heavy with it, you can add it to a training session anywhere. You will notice it most. Well, let's start over. If you're new to overhead squats, you're gonna feel it through the wrists. If you're a veteran overhead squatter, but you're new to this jam, you're gonna feel it through here like crazy. Play with your depth. It doesn't have to be super deep. In fact, your goal is to add a little bit of depth to it as you go. You're trying to go a little deeper. You're trying to get a little more depth out of it while still trying to keep that steel V in place. Man, look at those pits. Sorry about that. You don't need a barbell. It can be done with just a PVC pipe or a broomstick and just some light weights dangled from it. I do recommend bands because not only are they gonna wobble back and forth, but they're gonna be a little bouncy as well. So you're getting heckled in multiple directions. The most heckle you can get in the world. So that's the overhead squat with dangly bits. Now let's hit the road. The Cossack squat. Obviously, these make an appearance quite a bit in my videos, as does my dog. I'm going to, of course, advocate them as a very important squat variation. There's a unique type of mobility and strength that's involved in these. You can play with them, lots of variations. You can stay low, you can come up and down. You can even jump. Switch, jump. Again, there's much more instruction on these on my website. You go the depth you can over time, they'll get lower and lower. And this is another one of those cases where maybe the heels down isn't always the best thing. In fact, they used to be practiced regularly on the toes. You can find videos and pictures of one of my mentors, Bonnie Pruden, practicing them on the toes, which I think is traditionally how they do them actually as a dance. But whoa, I'm not entirely sure. If you've watched my videos, you've seen me transition from a Cossack into other things as well. It's a great transition tool. So not only is it a beautiful movement in itself, but it can transition into a bunch of other interesting things. So have some fun with it, the Cossack squat. That's it, Cossack squats, have fun with them. Possibly heard of the Bulgarian split squat. I don't know why Bulgaria gets all the attention when it comes to strength naming things, because they've got several things named after them. There's the Bulgarian bag and there's the Bulgarian squat and who knows what else. It could be because right around the end of the Cold War, Bulgaria was really well known for... I'm sorry, what?
Bulgaria.
Bulgaria. I know that. It sits right on the Red Sea.
Black Sea.
Its capital is Budapest.
Sofia.
Which sits right at the base of the rocky...
Vitosha
Mountains. The cicadas are out. Suddenly it's like a Lord song. Topical pop culture reference. So anyway, towards the end of the Cold War, Bulgaria and a lot of the other Balkan countries seemed to be doing really well in strength sports, particularly weightlifting. They were sort of dominating weightlifting at the time, and so the eyes of the world were looking at them, trying to figure out what they were doing. That might have led to several things falling under the title of Bulgarian. Before that, these historically have been known as elevated rear leg split squats or elevated rear leg lunges,
because split squats and lunges were synonymous. Point being, they're popular. They've been trending for some time. A lot of the hip, cool, functional trainers have been recommending these a whole bunch. And they're not wrong. They're just a little dogmatic about it. See, each one of them sort of recommends a different version of where to put your feet, how your hips should be, how your body should be aligned, should you be upright, should you be hinged, should your feet be wide or narrow, should your knees go over the toe, should they never go over the toe, or whatever. We're gonna do a little variation of the Bulgarian split squat, and the only principle I recommend is keep your hips square.
Straight ahead.
As I mentioned in the 1.5 leg good morning video recently,
join us today as we blast our glutes.
There seems to be some evidence that suggests that back pain can be a symptom of split leg or one leg exercises because of the twisting of the hips. So keep your hips square. Think of there being laser beams coming out from each hip.
I'm not wearing lasers.
And you want those laser beams to always be pointed straight ahead. You don't want a laser light show with them shooting around. Other than that, remember earlier when we were talking about squats and how we all have a different shape and how we're all gonna have different looking squats. We all have different lever systems and mobility structures and muscular systems. That applies here as well. Find the position that works for you and then try this little variation, which is simply a jump. Doesn't have to be a big jump. In fact, what do I always say is more important than the jump? Landing. You don't need weight for this one. In fact, I recommend it without weight because the goal is to create explosiveness, go for speed. And here's a big trick. Start the jump from the bottom of the squat. Now that sounds like an obvious statement, but when you see people do jump squats or explosive push-ups where they leave the ground, usually they do a squat or a push-up and then the last 3 inches is where the pop comes from. Try anything you do explosively from the bottom of the movement all the way through. Again, it sounds obvious, but it's actually not practiced that much. So drive your foot into the ground from the very bottom of this squat and leave the ground and land softly like a ninja kitten. Remember, the landing is super important. By the way, Bulgaria, no insult meant. I really would love to go there. It's on my list of places to check out. Your city of Sofia, which I hope I'm pronouncing correctly, has had inhabitants for over 9,000 years. Plus, let's face it, you got mountains, you got an ocean. It's a beautiful looking country. I'll be there soon. Hey, I'm gonna throw a little commercial of my own right in the middle of this video. I'm gonna take 15 seconds of your time here and just ask that if you like any of my videos, if you're a regular watcher of my videos, please share them. Let's grow the tribe together. Put the word out that, hey, this guy's got something interesting to say and you might enjoy it as well. I'd appreciate it. Several of you have joined my website. Many of you participate on the Facebook group. And quite a few of you have reached out via email and other social media. And I appreciate the dialogue. It's awesome that no matter where we are in the world, we can chat with each other. So I'm just asking if you could help grow this tribe a little bit more and maybe share one of these videos or all of these videos or a playlist or something. I appreciate it. Thanks. Back to the video. I feel you and I have had the conversation about Hindu squats quite a bit before. They help shoot my hips forward. And if we haven't, feel free to check out some other videos where I actually go into depth about how to do them. You actually get full instruction about a Hindu squat. You don't have to visit my website for that one. Although they are on there too. They fall into a category that is now known as the knees over toes squats. The Hindu squat is just sort of a nice catch-all. You can do it anywhere, you don't need any special equipment, you can do it as part of a workout, and it really does not only help the knees, but build your legs, and can help with performance in general. They're part of my daily practice, and my knees have been much better for it. The single leg squat. This one, like, say, a Bulgarian split squat, has a lot of variations to it. There's a lot of progressions that lead up to it. For as simple as it is definitely not an easy squat, at least for a lot of people, including myself. Remember how all bodies are shaped differently and therefore squat differently? This is a prime example of that. Sometimes called a shrimp squat, used to be called a single leg lunge and then a single leg split squat. I just call it a one leg squat. But there are a ton of progressions that lead up to it. It is in several of my programs on my website. So have fun exploring it. It's a very potent squat. It has a lot of crossover. And again, the big rule I'm gonna say, like with any single leg squat or split leg squat, try to keep your hips square. Go for it.
Five squat variations, for the most part, don't require much equipment and do a lot more than just get you stronger at doing that squat. I love a good barbell squat. You should know that about me. I've done a lot in my life with heavy barbells. They've been a key player in many things for me, but
Something about these movements does seem to have a perpetual transfer to other things. For a lot of us, these are real nice manifestations of the three P's. You gotta be present, they have to have purpose, and you gotta be very precise. So, thanks for watching, thanks for inspiring. This video is actually a manifestation of some requests I've had from you. And thanks for subscribing, hopefully, clicky clicky down below. Share this if you like. Meanwhile, be strong, eat clean, Netflix dirty. Overhead squats are... That sounds like a coyote.